We have a very interesting story that we'd like for you to also take a look at. Ghanaian philosopher and author, Prof. William. He's a former vice chancellor of the University of Ghana. Prof. William Abraham says the only way Africa can truly develop is when we understand what is at stake. As the former MP for Cape Coast and the first African to be to act as the vice chancellor of the University of Ghana, he says the current educational structure must give more relevance to history. He shared thoughts from his book titled The Mind of Africa, which Alfred Okanse, shared in this interview. Take a look at this.
Born in 1934, William Emmanuel Abraham is a Ghanaian philosopher and author of The Mind of Africa, first published in 1962. William attended school at the Addis Adel College in Cape Coast, Ghana, and went on to study philosophy at the University of Ghana, Legon, and then at Oxford University. At Oxford, he became the first African Fellow of All Souls, and his interest in African politics quickly developed into a Pan-Africanist perspective. The Mind of Africa, written whilst at All Souls, was a fruit of that enlarged perspective. He is back to Ghana, his homeland, after a very long stay away. I visited him to have a conversation on his perspective on what is in the mind of Africa.
History is an integral part of our forward march to development as a country. And as we are talking about the year of return and also the way forward for us as a people, we're going to be engaging in conversations that will bring the right perspectives to certain issues of national development. And today, Professor William Abraham is my guest, and I'm going to be talking about his life. He is, to date, the first and only black man to have risen to be part of the All Souls Fellowship. And that is a very, very noble achievement globally. And he's been honored for it. Professor,
for the time. Alfred, it's a pleasure.
First of all, let me find out from you. You've been away from Ghana for a very long time. How does it feel being back to Ghana?
It's wonderful. For many years, the longer I stayed away, the more tentative I felt about coming back. So my first visit was not as enjoyable. I don't know what happened, but this time I feel as if I have never left. Of course, part of the reason is that, pleasantly enough for me, many people who see me say they are surprised at how young I look. Nobody tells me in America that I look young. Yes. So I feel at home. I'm back home. That's what it is. I couldn't get out of the airport before I left. You get out of the airport, turn right, you're in Legon in no time. Bushes are all. Now I can't get out of the airport without a map. It's a completely different country, as it should be after 6 years or so. Yeah. Being on the land was thrilling to me. You remember the popes, they used to kiss the ground when they landed. But I think it would have been a spectacle if I had done that at the airport. Yeah. But that's how I felt inside. I felt as if I never wanted to live here again. Thrilled. But alas, I have to go back.
I mean, I recall that during your visit in 1962, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah impressed on you to stay back. How easy or difficult was it for you to take that decision?
Well, it was surprising to me because I came to Ghana at that time for a purpose. I had been interested in the 18th century Ghanaian boy who was taken to Europe, Anton Wilhelm Amu, and became a professor of philosophy in three German universities. So I came to see whether there are any traditions of him around Axim, where he came from. The president, President Nkrumah, knew that I was in the country. So out of the blue for me, he asked whether I would like to come to lunch with him at Flagstaff House. I didn't know the exact reason. So in the middle of lunch, he scratched his head and then said, "Tell me, you are the philosopher. We have non-Ghanaians teaching in Ghanaian universities. because we don't have enough Ghanaians to do it. And you are in a European country teaching them where they have lots of people to teach them. Explain the logic of it to me. Well, I was a young man in my 20s, full of enthusiasm and idealism. So it's like scales falling from my eyes. I said, yes, I get your point. So at that time, at that point, I knew that I would be staying in Ghana, even though I did not decide immediately, because I had to inform people at All Souls and find out how they felt about it. But I did stay, yes.
How long did you stay after 1962?
Well, I actually came in 1962. And I left Ghana in 1968. Well, after the coup, I was at Ashafort like many people, but I was allowed to go back to Legon to teach. And then it became time to take a sabbatical year. Fortunately, an American university invited me to come and teach. I meant to come back actually because I had just the proverbial one suitcase when I got there. But towards the end, another institution asked whether I would like to come there to teach. So I wrote to the Provost Chancellor and asked whether I could stay another year. He said yes. And then they said, would you like to stay another year, and another year, and another year? So when I kept asking the Vice Chancellor, he said, now you have to make up your mind. Do you want to stay there or do you want to come back? So I thought I'd stay a little longer.
Our enemies are many, and they stand ready to pounce upon and exploit our every weakness. They play upon our vanities and flatter us in every kind of way. They tell us that this particular person or that particular country has greater or more favorable potentialities than the other. They do not tell us that we should unite, that we are all as good as we are able to make ourselves once we are free.
Did you understand the late Kwame Nkrumah's ideology? I mean, there was an ideological institute, but for you, did you understand that ideology that he was living by then?
Yes, yes. We had frequent chats. In fact, sometimes he would call me at 2 o'clock in the morning. I'd say, what are you doing? And I would say, what do you think people do at 2 o'clock in the morning? We had chats. You know, he called me to Flagstaff House frequently and had chats with me. Yes, I think I understood. First, that Ghana had a rich history. Ghana was independent before colonialism and before other invasions. And we thought that Ghana had a statecraft which worked very well, which was consensual. Well, I wouldn't say consensual, but which had lots of room for discussion. But when people came to a resolution, the resolution held. People didn't continue the fight after the matter was resolved. I thought that was a good idea. I shared that feeling about Ghana too. And not just Ghana, practically every African country, the people were like that. And he thought that what he needed to do was to help the country into lifting that foundation into the 20th century. I thought that was a noble calling, a worthwhile thing. He did a lot, actually. He did accomplish a great deal. By the time he left, he had to leave. Ghana was not quite the same as it had been in the earlier years. You know that there was a time when grenades were being lobbed around, and you cannot have grenades being lobbed around and not do anything about it. The question is what you do about it, not that you try to do something about it. But he did what he thought was to be done. Not everyone agreed with him on the steps he took. It was a difficult time. I think that the finances in Ghana too were not the same as when we became independent. And what he told me was that his visit, he was going to North Vietnam for Hanoi, actually, for a particular reason, that he had been trying to get some money from President Johnson, And President Johnson, in effect, said, why don't you go ask your communist friends? So he wrote to Ho Chi Minh and proposed that there be a discussion, a conference, to settle the Vietnam War. And Ho Chi Minh wrote back and said, well, my brother, if you think there is a chance in that, why don't you come over and discuss it with me? So as far as I know, and as he told me, that was his reason for going to Vietnam. Of course, he'd never reached Vietnam, and that plan just died, was brought to an end, yeah.
At what point the fallout between the UGCC and Dr. Kwame Nkrumah begin? I mean, what were the undercurrents that led to that, from your observation of things that happened then?
I was not a member of any party, actually. I didn't join any party. So I don't know, but I have impressions. Well, in a way, I can see that if you were responsible for an organization like the United Gold Coast Convention, and you called someone to come and help you, and then the person took over, you wouldn't sleep well. You wouldn't be very pleased. You wouldn't be applauding. So I think that they were not merely disappointed, but they were also greatly surprised, you know, at the rapidity with which Nkrumah seemed to gain a massive following in the country. Besides, the ideas of the leaders of the United Gold Coast Convention would not be the same as the ideas of Kwame Nkrumah. They were more likely, this speculation on my part, they were more likely to continue somewhat in the mold of the British colonial tradition. But Nkrumah wanted mass involvement. That does not mean just that the masses vote for you, but that they take part in determining the direction that the country will take. I don't think that was an example that the colonial administration set us.
In 1965, you were elected member of parliament for Cape Coast. Tell me about that period.
Well, it was very short-lived, as you know. But yes, I did become a member of parliament for Cape Coast until the government was overthrown. But that was not my main job. My main job was to be at the university. I was to be in education, you know, to teach. Unfortunately, another thing Nkrumah told me was that Ghana didn't have very many trained people. In fact, when I left Ghana to go to England for graduate studies, there were only 500 doctors in the whole country. 500, and most of them were in Accra, you know, and so forth. And so Nkrumah said, that's our situation, but we have to be a modern state. Now, to be a modern state, you cannot say, I'll take care of half of the things that modern states do and let the other half go. You have to do everything. So what happened and what needed to happen was that one person would be put in multiple positions so that everything is somewhat covered. Yeah, so that made life extremely hard. Many people were overworked. There was a time when I was chairperson or member of 33 committees. And at the time of the coup, that was the situation in which I was in.
You mentioned that, you know, it was, in your view, good for us to leave the Commonwealth then. Why were you advocating for that?
Well, I thought that the wrong thing to do would be to say nothing and to let it pass as if that were not a grave occurrence. The fact of the disparity in the treatment that would have been meted out, if it had been Ghana or Nigeria or Sierra Leone, an African, a black African country, taking similar steps, you know, that would not have been tolerated in London. But even verbal condemnation, if there had been severe verbal condemnation, that would have been something. But it was simply poo-pooed. That's the way that it appeared to us, that you shouldn't have done that, and so on and so forth. Can anyone imagine that's the attitude the British government would have taken towards Ghana or Nigeria if we too had unilaterally declared independence? No. if you have been suppressed.
Where do you want to see Ghana in the next 10 years?
Well, I'm sure that Ghana will develop and be good. It will be full of good people. It is true that all the moral evil in the world is due to human beings. God has not come down to commit crimes or anything like that. It's human beings, we who commit all the crimes in the world. And part of human development is that we become more and more as God meant us to be, become loving creatures. That means a friendly, amenable society. It will come. Otherwise, God would have failed.
Prof, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Right on.